Just north of Lovelock, Nevada, in a remote patch of desert, remains of a once top secret spy plane have been scattered on the dusty ground since it crashed in 1967. I wanted to see the pieces for myself and learn about Nevada's history of aviation testing, so I met up with a local nuclear scientist and aircraft enthusiast, Taylor Wilson, and asked him to show me the crash site.
This, to me, is one of the most interesting facets in the history of science and technology, and this is an SR-71 Blackbird.
One of the reasons Taylor is so fascinated with the Blackbird is because 60 years after it started flying, it still maintains the record for the fastest manned jet aircraft ever built.
It was the first plane to be made primarily out of titanium because titanium was the only metal that could handle the heat associated with supersonic flight in this regime, you know, three times the speed of sound. So many things about this aircraft were incredibly ahead of their time. It's probably no surprise that this thing spawned a lot of, you know, UFO reports.
This is the desert of Western Nevada. The name of this isolated spot in Nevada is Watertown, and its very isolation is of the greatest importance.
The CIA wanted to develop their top secret spy planes in the most remote area possible. Since the Nevada test site had already been developed for nuclear testing, it was the perfect location to test aircraft. What would become known as Area 51 was born.
If you say Area 51, the first thing someone will think of is aliens, when they should be thinking airplanes.
Peter Merlin is an aerospace historian who has been researching the history of Area 51 since 1984. With the Cold War at a fever pitch, secrecy was a top priority. Trying to evade Russian defenses meant pushing aircraft design to the absolute limit. And Area 51, just north of Las Vegas, was often the first stop for these experimental planes.
For the last, you know, 60, 70 some odd years, most of the most interesting developments in United States military aerospace has flown out of that site, including the SR-71.
The Blackbird that crashed north of Lovelock was on its final leg of a night training flight when the pilot noticed that although the instruments indicated a straight and level flight, the aircraft was actually flipped on its side, which led to the pilot losing control.
The pilot and the reconnaissance systems officer ejected, and the plane continued into the ground where it dug this nice crater. And that's what happens when an SR-71 Blackbird engines go in full tilt, hits the desert floor.
Both crew members survived, and according to the crash report, the debris was buried on site. Peter Merlin told us it's not unlike UFO crash retrieval stories.
We have spacecraft from another species.
We do.
Except that the UFO crash retrieval stories always end with the words, and they cleaned up every trace. Whereas, you know, my version of going to these sites is, no, they didn't.
So we loaded up Taylor's Jeep and drove out to see what the government left behind. Leaving the paved road, we drove up a dry creek bed to get to the site. And you don't want to get caught out here without a four-wheel drive car and a spare tire.
What I love about these places, whether I'm looking for uranium or spy planes or atomic bombs, is you would never think this spot was interesting. It's just an average spot out in the desert, but little do they know. So if you look, that crater is directly in front of us, or was directly in front of us, the impact site. Pilot was actually picked up right, maybe half mile that way. Here's the wash.
Yep.
The wash that we were driving in. You can see at the back end, see the change in topography?
Yeah, it's right before that.
It's basically in between the two washes.
As we walked around the nearly 60-year-old crash site, pieces of the plane were everywhere.
What's crazy to me about this is that this titanium, do you know where it came from?
No.
To build the planes?
No.
Came from the Soviet Union. The very country that was being spied on was the supplier of the titanium for this aircraft.
Taylor has been to the site a number of times. For this trip, he put down red flags to mark pieces to get an idea of how far the debris was spread. He said the site is unique because of the quantity of material left behind.
4AA4C, 2C, LH. So we can look that up and figure out what part of the aircraft that came from, but that's a cool piece. It usually takes me a couple tries. You know, I've done a lot of mapping and a lot of detective work, but This site, first time I came out here, came down that wash, and I had a general idea where it was. I got out of the car and I started walking. And walked for a little while, and then all of a sudden, and I picked up something like that, and I knew where we were.
Yeah. I mean, you're holding a pretty significant piece of military history and also Nevada history. The concept for this plane was started here. It was developed here. And then the plane found its final resting place out here in the desert. Luckily, the pilots ejected and left.
Yeah, and luckily, it's a pretty rural place. You know what this is?
No. Oh, is that a piece of the coating?
No. That is a piece of the tire.
Oh, wow.
Yes, that is a SR-71 tire piece.
Oh, that's cool.
As we left the site, I couldn't believe that pieces of this plane, which were at one time one of the most closely guarded national secrets, were just left out to weather the elements. What must have people in rural Nevada have thought when it streaked through the sky to its final resting place? The dry hills just north of Lovelock, Nevada.